So my name is Kara Wu. I'm a research scientist at Sage Bionetworks, and I'm really pleased to be moderating this panel on open science matters. This is the first panel discussion of the morning, and the goal is really to have a discussion about the current state of open science, successes, challenges, areas of opportunity. And one of the things that I love about the assembly is just the incredible breadth and depth of perspectives, expertise, backgrounds that that everyone comes in with. And so I know that's absolutely true of our panelists. It's also true of all of you. So I think it will be a really interesting discussion, and I'm looking forward to hearing the thoughts from the panelists as well as questions from the audience. Speaking of the panelists, we have a really stellar lineup this morning. Carly Strasser from the Fred Hutchinson Cancer Research Center, Dario Tarabarelli from the Chan Zuckerberg Initiative, Deborah Estrin from Cornell Tech, and Clifford Lynch, just right on time, from the Coalition for Networked Information. And apologies for the microphone shuffle last minute. That was my fault. So I'll let the panelists introduce themselves in more detail in just a moment. Before we get started, I would like to acknowledge that we are on the traditional land of the first people of Seattle, the Duwamish people, past and present, and I want to honor with gratitude the land itself and the Duwamish tribe. With that said, I would love if our panelists could go down the line, introduce themselves, their background, and their connection to open science.
Does that mean I'm starting?
I think that means you're starting.
All right, so I'm Carly Strasser. I work just down the road at the Fred Hutchinson Cancer Research Center, which we call Fred Hutch. And I work alongside the chief data officer there and have a lot of partners and collaborators thinking about how we can advance data-intensive research at the Hutch through partnerships and other kind of modes of things like training and seminars. And I came at this as an oceanographer, not cancer research, and I ended up in this space of open science after working at the California Digital Library years ago on the data repository and the DMP tool there. So it's a space that I have been in for a while, and it's a really great community, and I'm really excited to be here. This is my first Sage Assembly, and I've been watching with envy for the last few years, so I'm really happy to be here.
This is also my first Sage Assembly, so really excited to be here today. My name is Dario Tarabarelli. I'm the Science Officer for Open Science at the Chan Zuckerberg Initiative. The Chan Zuckerberg Initiative, the science initiative within CZI, has a goal to cure, prevent, or manage all diseases by the end of the century. And open science is one of the key vehicles that the organization believes we can leverage to meet those goals. And so I'm started recently, and I'm really excited about like the opportunities in that space. My own background is in social computing, so a mix of computer science and behavioral science. And so I'm learning what are the challenges in the biomedical community coming from that perspective, and it's been really instructive so far. And prior to CZI, I was with the Wikimedia Foundation, what I led research, and so I've seen also challenges around open data, code sharing, and open science from a slightly different perspective than just like the academic perspective.
So I'm Deborah Estrin. I'm now professor of computer science at Cornell Tech, and before then was at UCLA, as Chris mentioned, a great decade collaborating together. So before that, I really started out of grad school being part of the Internet Engineering Task Force and the Internet Protocol community. So I was weaned, if you will, career-wise on open modular architectures, rough consensus, and running code. And as is with most of us, I think our first intense 10 years as professionals probably informs everything else we do. That's the perspective I bring to it. And I brought that perspective to SENS and the work we tried to do there as we moved from the network of routers to the networks of sensors and began working in context with our customers in the room, in a sense. I was working with environmental engineers and ecologists, and we brought them in the room as we developed the technology and helped them develop the science. At least that was the aspiration. I think that notion of context that Chris mentioned in her discussion of mobilizing data is something we'll come back to talk more about. I took that on to, as I wandered into mobile health and really began interacting with the incredible folks at Sage through their co-launching of Research Kit and Bridge, and we did an Android equivalent of that, and it's been a wonderful number of years since then in that collaboration, and continue to be very interested in small data, sort of N of one, data science, digital biomarkers, and trying to do that with attention to privacy.
And I'm Cliff Lynch. I'm a computer scientist by training, and what I've been doing for the last 20 years or so is running a small not-for-profit in Washington, D.C. called the Coalition for Networked Information. Our members are mostly research universities, although there are some others. And we work a pretty broad agenda around digital content and information technology in support of research and teaching in higher education. This has taken us into areas like research data management, digital preservation, how the system of scholarly publication is changing, all of these things that are directly implicated with and interact with the move towards open science. Open science increasingly feels to me like it's, and really I should say from our perspective, open scholarship more broadly, because this is a movement that goes way beyond the sciences, is now increasingly the driver as scholarly practice changes for changes that are occurring throughout the broader supporting infrastructure and system.
Thank you all for those introductions. So as this panel is intended to be a discussion on the state of open science, my first question to you all is, what is the most interesting or perhaps surprising current trend in open science that you're excited about?
So I'll start. There's a lot of really exciting things happening in the open science space right now. There's a lot of interesting discussion online and a lot of energy around finding ways to make science more accessible to the public. I think that's really important. And one component of that that I think has been a really exciting development in the last couple of years is the discussion around open access, and particularly the attention that it's getting in California in the UC system, and their pushback on Elsevier's contracts. And I think open access and the discussions around costs and how to effectively navigate that have been going on in the library space for many, many, many years. But this is, I think the current trend part of this is really that that now people outside of the library care. So researchers are starting to pay attention more than they have in the past. There are articles in the popular press about it. There's discussions happening at higher levels that I think are really an indicator that we might actually be able to start moving the needle more than we have been able to in the past when those different groups maybe haven't always been super engaged in that discussion.
Yeah, from my perspective, something that I really noticed looking at open science across the board in many fields, has been the maturing of projects that are designed to engage the public, patients, volunteers, a variety of members of the public in the making, dissemination of science. So citizen science has been around forever, of course, but I think the last few years have been really critical in some areas. I'm gonna give you three examples. Citizen science for biodiversity. There's now not just a timing of these efforts, but the critical mass of participation in people just snapping pictures of species in their surrounding and using these to inform conservation efforts, research on the impact of climate changes on local economies, conservation, again, modeling ecology. So many applications that were just unthinkable of a few years ago that are now becoming possible. Curation of linked data. I come from the experience of Wikimedia and seeing the growth and maturing of communities like Wikidata, so an open knowledge base that anyone can edit, and seeing how volunteers and experts can basically try and figure out together this impossible task of crowdsourcing data models for representing anything and figuring out ways to collaborate around data quality has been really impressive to watch. And finally, I want to say, even though I'm not an expert of this, I've learned from my colleagues at CZI, and Tania is here in the audience, she can speak more to this, but learning about how patient communities work and how, like the learning about the resourcefulness of patients in spinning up networks, connecting to researchers, figuring out how to, you know, get funding for the disease their families suffer from, identify the key leaders in the field. All of this is getting a ton of momentum, and I think this is something that is changing the way in which we think about public engagement. So again, the huge opportunity we have in thinking about how to design scientific workflows to engage the public from the very beginning.
Other thoughts?
I'll echo Dario on that. I think the health area here is really very powerful, and when you combine some of the developments with things like electronic medical records, with the emergence of these sort of patient communities connecting up to researcher communities, there's some very interesting things starting to happen there. But I think what I want to comment on a little bit, because I think it's kind of thematic here, is the interplay between top-down and bottom-up in open science. We are kind of coming out of the end of a period where there's been an awful lot of top-down activity about publishing in open access journals, about requirements from journals and from funders to make data available, this kind of thing. I'm seeing now, kind of anecdotally, a big resurgence of bottom-up stuff from specific scientific communities. And these are actually, in many cases, rather focused communities. You see it especially in the biomedical sciences, because of some of the structural way that institutions like NIH fund things and will fund these sort of clusters of researchers that are working on common problems. Those are becoming very powerful, I think, because there's something in it for the researchers. It's not just that they're doing this to make some funding agency happy, but rather, they are collectively enhancing their own research by sharing data and upgrading that data as they share it. The data becomes sort of a living thing as opposed to a very static object. I think that we've made a very bad sort of mental picture mistake where we think about scientific data sort of as FTP sites, right? You do your science, you produce some data sets, they go on the shelf someplace, and maybe someday later, someone else pulls it off the shelf and reproduces your result or repurposes your data for something else. But in fact, if you really go out and look at what's happening in some of these more limited scope communities, the data is a living thing that is being shared and enhanced and curated actively. And that requires platforms and practices that are a lot more sophisticated and very community specific, I think, often, than this sort of, you know, FTP archive model that tends to drive so much conversation about research data management.
So I was just thinking about how when SAGE, when ResearchKit was launched, and SAGE, as I often refer to it, like had this Trojan horse, a beneficent Trojan horse, which had you have to, you know, explicitly opt out of having de-identified data shared for the sake of science. And from the first article that came out to the one that was in April, if my heart counts right, the publication comes out with a pointer to the data that's available. And it was really, there were the resources there to put that through, and they did it leanly, so that end to end, you have this data collection that's going on with sort of scientific citizens contributing to the science, and the hook is in there to have that data roll up and help to inform the science in aggregate. And I think that's just sometimes, as I, you know, from the early days of trying to do some participatory sensing, and now things have, when they get wrapped up in things like Visipedia and support like that, that comes, it's great, but often these smaller efforts don't necessarily ground up have that wrapping up in those hooks to pull them up to the broader community. And it would be great if we could do more of that.
Yeah. Yeah, and you know, one theme that I heard in all of your responses is this broadening of participation in research and in science or scholarship more broadly. And you know, I think one of the one thing that we run into in open science is a little bit of a tension between practicing open science in spirit versus in letter. And so one example that I am thinking of here is this phenomenon of what Olivia Guest termed broken science, which is this an enforcement of open science that ultimately becomes tantamount to gatekeeping. And so while we're trying to promote openness and hold each other to a high standard of sharing, I'd love to hear your thoughts on how we can at the same time encourage and actually reduce the barriers to participation and entry for the people who have needed it the most.
I'll take a crack at that. So I think it's a really critical, important question. And I've got to get straight to the point. I think that for open science to meet its goals and fulfill its vision, it needs to get rid of unintended exclusionary structures that it carries with its policies and its initiatives. I cannot think of like ways in which open science will succeed unless we figure out ways of like listening, incorporating the concerns of those communities and those practitioners that will have to carry the cost and the burden of implementing these practices. And all of this is well-intentioned, and I've been like myself part of many such initiatives, but it's really refreshing to see, you know, whenever you work in an initiative and you're like, okay, have you listened to ECRs? What is the voice of like women? What is the voice of underrepresented minorities or groups that are not at the table, like countries that may want to model their scientific practices around what larger institutions are doing, but they may not have the resources to implement them. So, yeah, all of this, I think there's no perfect solution for this, and I think like maybe the best example that I'm familiar with, which really exemplifies this, is like Wikipedia. Wikipedia as a poster child of open collaboration where anyone can participate, right? So just go ahead and create your article. It's easy in theory, but the practice shows that there are accessibility, literacy, socioeconomical barriers. There are all kinds of reasons why just a project being open and welcoming is not enough, right? So the very same problem applies to open science and science in general. And I think like there are many ways of tackling this problem. I think like one thing that we can do is to start monitoring any potential exclusionary structure in policy initiatives that we design. I'm thinking of, you know, AI research or AI applications in companies that need to start thinking about adversarial use cases when they build AI. I think the same approach needs to happen for open science when we think about like what are possible unintended consequences of designing a new initiative that may create disparate impact on some of the communities that it's designed for. And similarly, like thinking about ways of incentivizing credit and providing access to training for those groups and those organizations that are producing valuable outputs that very often are not those that unlock the benefits of these outputs. So figuring out how to rebalance access to credit and access to opportunities for funding for jobs for those researchers, those organizations that produce valuable outputs.
So I just want to add something that you said early on that I think is really true in the case of open science, which is there's a lot of parallels and integrations with the conversations around diversity, equity, and inclusion. And I think it's really hard to take those two things apart when you start to see the different ways that they interface with one another. And so I think in both cases of talking about open science or talking about diversity and inclusivity, you have to come at it with good faith and openness to having honest conversations that are sometimes not easy. I think thinking about the people that are potentially marginalized or unable to participate in open science is an incredibly valuable thing for all of us to try and participate in, even if it feels like it might not necessarily have an easy solution, right? So I think thinking about these things in concert is gonna be really important as we move forward, not just to make sure that we have maybe people that don't have as much access or people from other countries represented in the science, but when we think about the data sets, we need to make sure we have all of these groups represented. When we think about the surveys that we're putting out to patient populations, we need to think about things like, what is the gender question gonna reflect in the data when we get that back, and how do we wanna handle that data? So I think those are the types of conversations that are gonna be really important for us to have in good faith moving forward as a community.
I mean, just to make a very messy, difficult problem seemingly less solvable is, all the discussion around the census mm-hmm. and the citizenship question, the damage done by even raising it, right? We have the same problem in participatory research, particularly just location, right? As a data type that we collect, and the sensitivity of that and how that can be simply a point of fear for vulnerable communities. So it's sort of at every level quite difficult, and I just think the conversation is probably how we bring them back down to the particular context of any particular science problem is an interesting mm-hmm. challenge.
Yeah, absolutely. And recognizing that if you make something as open and transparent as possible, you are going to have people that might call you on some of the challenges or the things that you referenced that maybe aren't as accessible or available for certain populations. And so I think, again, coming at it from a place of good faith and trying your best, but not necessarily always hitting the mark and being okay with that as a community, I think is gonna be really important.
Yeah, so Deborah, the point that you raised around location and citizenship and these questions that can be quite sensitive and disproportionately so for certain populations, I think also really gets to the importance of privacy and the tension that can sometimes exist between openness and privacy, which is something that we think about at Sage quite a lot. Sharing data carries with it many risks that that are not always knowable in advance, and those risks are the greatest for the people who are already the most marginalized and vulnerable. So as we are advocating for more openness, what responsibilities, or if you want to think of it as opportunities, do we as open science advocates carry to ensure the safety and autonomy of all participants in research?
So, and this is again, when I find problems like this overwhelming, right, they're so hard to answer in general. So it's really part of our process has to be how we do it in the specific context. And Chris talked about in her address, this problem of how do you mobilize or how do you make data mobile so that it really carries with it the context that the original data collector, scientist, and effort had with it. And I think that Helen Nissenbaum's work in contextual integrity as a framing for how you think about privacy. Privacy, data does by themselves as elements don't have enough information to tell you what privacy policy relates to it. Privacy needs to be use-based and needs to be in the context of the appropriate data flows in the context of that data. And so it makes it more complicated, but we need to bring that kind of framing down to when we define a data collection effort, what are the use-based policies associated with those data that we collect even from individuals. And so it's just a meta answer in how we need to approach it. That said, coming down to specifics, location was the first data stream that sort of like brought me into health personally, just as a random anecdote, when we were exploring mobile phones as sensors, because I bring my previous context every problem I look at. So when I saw mobile phones, you know, in 2005, 6, I just, oh, cool, a wireless sensor that's more robust than a moat, right? And so, but it was first this location data. Wow, we have this like continuous location data. It's now so trite. But it's extremely telling and extremely problematic. And I think that from a surveillance perspective and a vulnerability perspective, it just requires extreme attention to it in terms of what we ask from individuals and what we might disclose even in data sets that attempt to be de-identified. So it's not an answer, it's just how important that process needs to be in every case.
If I could jump on that one, I also want to tie it back to some of the discussion we were just having about opening up these processes, because the whole question of privacy as opposed to data sharing also has a big trust element implicated in it. There are people who will agree to share data with some entity with the confidence and the understanding that that entity will treat the data appropriately. And many of the problems, I mean, certainly the census issue, you know, the real fear there to a great extent is that the answers to that will get improperly shared out. It won't simply be kept in a very, you know, deep silo inside the census. I think we're gonna run into this just endlessly as we get into genomic and patient record data, and also behavioral data, the sorts of things like you know, tracking telemetry that you were just talking about. Trust then takes us back to questions about governance, transparency, and on.
Not to say everything's dire. I think it's really hard, and I think these are all super great points. I am really optimistic, though. There's a lot of interesting work happening kind of along the vein of cool new trends in open science. There's some great work around consent that's happening at Sage. There's a lot of really interesting things coming out of even, you know, tech companies. We have a partnership with Microsoft where we're talking to them about differential privacy and how to use that as a model for protecting patient privacy while also being able to share data so that we can have these more robust data sets where we can really start to come up with interesting solutions to biology problems. And so there is a lot of work happening. I think it's really encouraging that there's so much interest in ethics in data science and ethics in data sharing and open science. I think this is the right time for us to be having those conversations very early in all of these processes. Again, good faith, we're not gonna get it right the first time. There was just an article that came out yesterday, the day before, in Nature that basically said there's no way to de-identify anything ever. So, you know, there's certainly lots of indications that this is hard, but I think we have some really awesome work that's happening in this space that could go a long way towards getting us to a place where we can share data effectively and still manage the privacy of folks.
And yes, and to echo that, thank you for pulling me out of it. I find I need that about 10 times a day. So first of all, yeah, Microsoft Research, John Crum did work in the very, very, very early days around looking at the questions of how can you share geolocation data while trying to do some protection of where somebody actually lives. And so they really have it from the early days that they think about this. And I think this is a perfect time to, you know, ask John Wilbank sitting over there, like the incredible work that he and the others did for e-consent let's take this on. Let's take something around this on to set those guidelines, practices, all the way down to something as pragmatic as a set of, visuals that could be used to make it happen.
It makes me like the biggest challenge I've seen is really for the public to you know, for people and organizations that are producing data, is to understand the trajectory, the way data travels, and the legal and technical ways of controlling this. And so that goes back to the question of trust, because trust, we're not in a world in which you donate your data to a specific entity. You need the data, and that data travels. And how to figure out understandable ways for the public to conceptualize the trajectory of data and the control they may have, I think, is super important.
One thing I do wonder about is, I'm sort of struck that, at least speaking parochially about the United States for a minute as opposed to the rest of the world, there actually does seem to be some discussion at the policy and legislative level now about privacy legislation of various kinds. But most of it seems framed about data breaches and punishment for data breaches and things like this, as opposed to preventing bad uses of data which could be used for good and ill. You know, an interesting example of what I at least would consider a prevent bad uses is the pre-existing condition business on insurance, where they basically said everybody's a level playing field, so you don't have to worry about, well, if they can find out that there's something wrong with me, I'll never get insurance. One wonders whether we might not see some new public policy conversations about the analysis or use of data in other sorts of ways. That's a trend that might be worth keeping an eye on. It might be actually quite useful to be thinking about what sorts of policies focused around use rather than collection might facilitate the growth of open science in the biomedical areas.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, do you have any thoughts or ideas about what that might look like, what that kind of legislation might look like, any of you?
I think there's a piece about liability. Many people now, because it's proven so difficult, maybe impossible, to anonymize data in a meaningful way, are terrified to share it. And basically, the lawyers get into it, and it's just, well, we can't share this. The risks are too great. Trying to work that angle and the liability related there might be a point. Another one that's very striking is this reuse of genomic data that you're seeing was alluded to earlier. That's only going to get more and more severe. And I haven't heard a lot of conversations about the pros and cons of limiting that.
Mm-hmm. Also, it's a common refrain that I think training and education around this space is really critical moving forward, not just for the public, but for researchers and for legislators. There was recently someone speaking at Congress and it became very apparent that the person they were speaking to didn't understand, the model for how Google works and why they make money. And it's, those are the kinds of things where you're like, wow, we have a vastly different level of knowledge when it comes to data and technology in the US. And I think, worldwide, but I think as time goes on and this younger generation that was raised, entrenched in their data being part of this communication with the world, then I think we might see these laws start to take a shape in a way that are going to be more effective at helping with some of these privacy issues.
Yeah, and I think too, you spoke to training and education. We do have people coming up now who live in a very different world technologically than we grew up in, but I think that it's also, we want to avoid the risk of assuming that just because they grew up with phones and they have, you know, access to all this data that automatically comes with literacy about, you know, how it can be used and what for. So
definitely, yeah, they probably are clueless in very different ways, but clueless nonetheless.
Yes, I mean, it is striking to me how genuinely bad a job we do in, it's really not even, you know, colleges, but K through 12, about giving kids as they grow up some sense about how the world works and what these devices do. You know, they know how things work functionally, right? You can type things into Google and you'll get something back, or you know, my cell phone can tell me how to get from here to there, but the question of, well, who's your cell phone talking to and what's it saying? Really just doesn't come up. And it seems to me that there's this real substantial body of technical literacy that needs to get mainstreamed into the K through 12 educational curriculum.
Mm-hmm. There's we did a lot of that sense, but there's a lot in New York City where I am now, Diane Levitt, my colleague at Cornell, but the citywide, there's an effort to do this like CS for All and bringing CS education in K through 12. Maybe this is one of the most important reasons to do it. It's not, you know, it's phrased as trying to, you know, raise the workforce for
teach
those same tech companies,
code,
everyone
yes.
to code, right? But this kind of literacy is far more important.
And I like that we already got to the kids these days part of the panel. That's super
yeah.
awesome.
We have a
days.
Lawn somewhere.
Yeah.
We can tell them to get off.
But I also want to reiterate that at the Hutch, we think a lot about how to support researchers in their work. And I think open science is a lot about transparency, reproducibility. Those things often go hand in hand with computational skills and with a knowledge about how programming works and being able to document that in a way that people can actually recreate the things that you've done and the results that you've got. So, you know, I'm really excited to see that there is some recognition at the Hutch, at least, where we're starting to realize the importance of that training and how critical it is that researchers are coming in, and if they don't already have those skills, then we really need to find ways to give them those skills so that they can be active participants in open science and in computational research.
Say a word to complement that. So within CCI and the different programs that we fund across different areas of biomedicine, we ran surveys to understand the computational needs of trainees, and something emerged really strongly from the survey suggesting that there are types of skills that typically PhD students and postdocs don't get through formal training in university, and it is becoming now absolutely critical for them to be able to do their job. Figuring out ways to effectively level up those skills that involve like anything from like being able to interact with data, manipulate data, leverage like a computational, like executable, like computational notebook technology. This is something that is going to become more and more critical for many disciplines. And right now, we're not providing that level of expertise and training through the institutional channels.
Mm-hmm. Which, I mean, to reverse the, you know, kids these days conversation, sometimes the leadership at these large organizations, I worked at the Moore Foundation promoting data intensive research through data science centers, places like the UW Science Institute or the NYU Center for Data Science. And what we found was that often the administrators and the leadership at the high levels of the university just weren't very familiar with the idea that this is really important, right? So, you know, we gotta wait for that generation to die off so we can take over. That's the opposite, I guess, of, you know, kids these days. But, you know, how do we get these programs in place when often the top leadership don't necessarily value something like training or computational research in, you know, the biology department, for instance. So that's part of this conversation, too, I think.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that is really emerging as critical in some of the work that we've been looking at CNI lately is how we teach graduate students this whole set of data management and computational tools and skills, things like software carpentries, those sorts of things. They're not getting that in the sort of standard curriculum that the departments lay out in many cases. This is coming from other organizations, support organizations, the library, the IT organization. And yet those people are so critical because they're the ones that will drive the change. Mm-hmm. It's those people as graduate students, as PhD students and postdocs, mm-hmm. Not working, you know, down from the top in those organizations.
Yeah, these skills are, I mean, with some exceptions, as you said, not being taught as widely as they need to be, and you know, the scientists coming out of these programs are still expected to, you know, write code, develop software, make it all available, and do this whole list of things that that maybe in the past they weren't expected to without sometimes the support of senior leadership. And so that poses, I think, a real challenge for sustainability of this type of work, of open work, where, you know, it's a challenge to get these skills. It's not always supported, yet it's expected from other sides. And so I would love to hear your all's thoughts on the sustainability of open work in general and how we can ensure that moving forward.
Well, let me just say a couple things about this, because this seems to be a thematic concern that you know, I've spent decades dealing with in various contexts. The whole nature of open scholarship seems to have a particular knack for framing these sustainability problems in a way that some of the older structures did not. For example, you know, the largely commercialized system of scholarly publication that we're trying to really change the structure of now didn't have the same problems. It had some other sustainability problems, like library budget pressures were becoming unsustainable, but they were quite different in character. When you look at open science, it seems to me to imply and demand these platforms for sharing work and sharing data and discoveries. And these things need to be put in place and maintained. And simply having them go away at the end of a grant is, you know, it's just totally unacceptable. Now, one of the things I do take some solace in is that my sense is that NIH, at least, is really starting to understand this more. And so, for example, I understand that they are going to be starting to make a new class of grant available, I believe, this fall, to fund resources for ongoing support of biomedical information resources, as opposed to you try and dress these things up as a research grant to keep the resource alive. One could only wish that the National Science Foundation would get on the program with this, but I would say they've been more resistant to it. But we really do have a structural problem here, and as I see, as I was describing earlier, this move from thinking about just file archives, which are relatively inexpensive infrastructure to maintain, to sophisticated computational science support platforms, which are expensive to maintain, I'm becoming more and more concerned about how we deal with sustainability here. I guess the one other thing I should say is that as I see what's happening in scholarly communication, it's getting harder and harder for me to see how, as we move into the future, what happens on these platforms is separate from the scholarly record. It is going to be the scholarly record, and so we have to manage it from that context as well.
Yeah, maintenance is not sexy. There's nothing glamorous about or nothing easily fundable about saying, hey, I need resources to be able to continue to operate this service. It's so critical to large parts of science. I have a very related story that I wanted to tell. So we recently launched a program at Chan Zuckerberg Initiative to fund what we call essential open source software for science. And this program is far from being the solution to the sustainability of open source or scientific infrastructure, but it came from the realization that, again, there are many gaps in funding or opportunities that ironically start emerging when some of these highly adopted platforms that are really critical for many parts of science reach the level of maturity where they're not gonna sell the brand new idea, the greatest advance in
it's not research anymore.
But that's exactly the point where the need to have support for things that can be as mundane as writing documentation or convening your user base. Good luck, submitting a request for funding for saying I want to bring together people to help us make our documentation suck less. And so this is something that we started realizing as we designed this program. The question becomes how to make this invisible work visible and fundable. How to turn the invisible labor, and this applies not just at the level of infrastructure, but also at people. So going back to the question about these key roles that progressively institutions are realizing are absolutely critical in training new generations of scientists around computational skills. Right now, they're not necessarily visible. How do we make them visible, institutionalized, and supported? I think this is a big challenge that we need to work on.
Yeah, it's not just a matter of funding, right? Which I think is what you're getting at. It's much bigger. I think that having a conversation around sustainability also brings in things like incentives and what people are rewarded for in academic settings and how people are hired and promoted. And the conversations that we're having in those spaces, I think, very much can influence the overall perceptions, places like NSF or NIH, to really start to find ways to value these things. And I always love this story of Fernando, who started the Jupyter Notebooks, which is used incredibly widely by lots of folks. We funded them in part, the Moore Foundation, when I was working there. And he had a really hard time getting a faculty position because he spent all this time working on a piece of infrastructure. He's awesome, right? Fernando Perez, if any of you know him, he's an amazing person who has huge contributions under his belt that have really changed the way we think about documenting workflows and science. And yet, he couldn't find an academic job. I mean, he finally did, and he's at Berkeley now, and that's great. But watching him struggle with that was really eye-opening to me that we do not value these types of things in this space, and we have to keep pushing on administration and others, maybe people that aren't necessarily as convinced that computational research is the future, that these are things that we need to value. We need to value software and data and sharing those things and making your workflows reproducible and creating interesting R packages that people can reuse. I think those are all things that we need to find ways to reward and incentivize.
Really interesting conversation. I mean, it's about infrastructure to some extent and sort of how does a society and economy fund infrastructure? There's some notion of taxation and represent and respecting this public good. It would be interesting to have some, I don't know if there has been any sort of some economists take a look at, right, the economy of this, of this infrastructure. I was at a 50 year, it's the 50 year anniversary of a bunch of things, including the first packet sent on the ARPANET. So I was at something at MIT last week for NET at 50, even though I was a child, just to be clear, not that old. I recounted being at some SIGCOM, an academic conference with faculty who tenure track faculty, and somebody said, I don't remember who it was, HTTP 1 had just come out, right? And somebody said, this is such a brain dead protocol, it will never scale. So, did you say it?
Yes.
Finally, I have the story, so that's it. Wow, I've been repeating it. I started to think that I had just made it up in my head. Now, but it was a rational thing for them to say, because it wasn't academically interesting. It was not the topic of SIGCOM publication and sort of that piece of it. Yet, you know, the rest of that sentence doesn't need to be said. But that tension in the role in academia is just, mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah, and I really like the point you brought up that this is infrastructure. And, you know, one of the things that I always think about in terms of sustainability is, you know, it's great that granting agencies now are paying more attention to the, you know, less novel, you know, exciting kind of stuff, and more to the maintenance and continued support of existing tools. But at the end of the day, those are still, you know, time-bound, you know, grants that are not going to continue indefinitely, or there's no guarantee that they will. And I think that is a challenge that maybe calls for some more models to be examined.
So one thing I've been very heartened to see in the last year or so is some conversations setting up sort of funding pools to support mm-hmm. open software for science tools. There are two or three initiatives I'm aware of going on there that are bringing together money from higher ed institutions and organizations and private foundations. Mm-hmm. So I think the more, you know, different sources we can get there, moving away from just the usual big federal science funders, the more resilient and robust this is going to get.
Mm-hmm. And you're absolutely right. There are some like nascent initiatives. I'm thinking of the Invest in Open Infrastructure, Jay Ross, and similar initiatives. But back to your point, the question really becomes how to move this past the horizon of, say, short-term philanthropic or governmental funding, mm-hmm. right? And I think really the elephant in the room is we think about like how universities spend their money. I mean, right now, look at the allocation of money that goes into supporting the publishing industry, as opposed to supporting the needs of like a librarian's technical roles at universities, and how even a fraction of what goes into subscriptions or APCs could be repurposed to support, well, I mean, I'm just saying something, just preaching to the choir here. but that's why I think like, and we're, I think there's enough momentum at the moment mm-hmm. To start thinking about, hey, are we spending our money wisely? And if we want these efforts to be sustainable, if we want like some platform to be around in 10 years from now, how do we start spending less for publishing our output and more to sustaining people who maintain this infrastructure?
Yes, shifting the funding from just publications to the entire kind of breadth of scholarly outputs.
Exactly. Yeah. All right, well, thank you all for those very insightful thoughts. I think that we have a little bit of time for some audience questions, and so I would love to get a chance to hear from you all questions for the panelists. And I think that there are microphones roving around.
Okay. Hi, this was really fascinating. Pam Tenars with the Clinical Trials Transformation Initiative. One of the things that struck me as you were talking specifically towards the end about all these platforms that need to be funded and maintained is, like, I'm not sure why we're looking, and I don't know how you collaborate on this, but we should. Like why we should look at this as all individual platforms that sort of individually need to be maintained. It feels like it should be some global, like the roads. Like we all use them, we all need them. Like why make them all individual? Can we somehow figure out a way to make that more global? Like at least nationally, internationally, I don't know. It's hard, probably.
I feel like if you ask three scientists what they want to use, then you'll get like six answers. So that's really what it comes down to, right? Is that, and you know, you see it all the time in computational research. It's like, oh, well, there's this package that you could use to answer this interesting question. And they look at it and it doesn't do like one tiny little thing that they want it to do. And they're like, ah, I'm just going to start over and like do it from scratch. And so I think that's, it's very much built into the, maybe it's thinking about, you know, we're all a monoculture of scientists who think in that way. So maybe there's some re-education that needs to happen around, you know, yes, you're really smart and you could do this from scratch, but maybe you could also use things that are already there and in place. But it is, it's definitely difficult. And when I was a funder, it was something we asked a lot, which was, you know, someone came to us with a proposal and it's like, well, how does this differ from what's already there? And how can we either work with them or, you know, collaborate with them in such a way that we're not reinventing the wheel every time?
The other tension here, and it's a very real one, is that these platforms become more useful for supporting communities of scholars when they understand the shared semantics of the data among that community, which means now you've got us, you've either got to have some kind of platform that we don't know how to build today, as far as I can tell, which can support vast numbers of radically different semantics and host tons of these communities, or you're building specialized ones for each community. And it's not just the data semantics, there are also computational things around those data semantics.
I just want to add that, so the main takeaway from attending the sessions of the JROS initiative, so the Joint Roadmap
for Open Science.
Thank you. was the realization that all these ecosystems are like really important open platforms is extremely fragmented. It is small in scale. Like these are like very often like nonprofits or like institutions supporting like teams of like 2-3 people. And of course, and they're also like very focused on like individual parts of the workflow of supporting researchers. And when you compare that to vendors and companies that provide end-to-end solutions that have like a, you know, a support desk and somebody you can call to answer your questions, there's really no way for these projects to compare with this larger like for-profit driven effort. So something to me, like it goes back to what you were saying, is the fact that like these efforts are trying to build like community-driven infrastructure. They need to get more de-siloed, aligned. When you think about like services that can apply to all of these providers and platforms, to try and make them more competitive compared to like one company will offer everything to meet all the needs of the researchers, right?
All right, well, thank you all. Thank you for your attention. And I'm not sure, I think we have a break next, is that right?
At the same time?
All right, let's thank our panelists again. Thank you.
Hey.